For the ones who was not present on my yesterday presentation, I am Milan Martinovic. I'm working for Dell in cloud client computing division. We are dealing with desktop virtualization in that vertical. And I specialize as a sales engineer. It means that I am pre-sales for technical consultant in this kind of project. I don't think we will need the... I think everybody can hear me. So, yesterday I was showing some standard sales presentation talking about advantages of Dell, some general aspects of desktop virtualization. Today it is like a custom topic. I created most of the slides custom today. I wanted to present you and show you some examples what am I facing every day when talking to customers when it comes to switching from physical PCs to virtual infrastructure, what are the questions, what are the challenges, and I wanted to give some examples. So, there are some prices used in some slides. I wanted to show some examples of prices. So numbers I took from the internet, so take this as approximate price, because exact price would depend on exact quote for your specific project. So this is all presentational, don't call me for every number. Yeah? So, what is the situation today in our data set? So, normally, in our companies, we have some server-side infrastructure in the data center. We have some desk workers or mobile workers working with PCs, laptops, with local applications, relying on the services that are provided from the data center. This could be some data for business application, for email application, like Exchange server, different services can be in the data center. This was like that many years ago. Then we introduced virtualization in the data center to simplify the operations with the server systems, to unify the hardware, to make the migration easier, to make additional tasks we need to do with the servers, like providing high availability, replication backups, you can work with snapshots. Virtualization in the data center is making our life much easier with the servers. Then we needed to introduce hypervisor on the as a bare metal installation on the server. Today we have different options. Most common are Hyper-V and vSphere that I see today. And usually we have introduced central storage to store the files of virtual machines and other data. Then, what I see today as a possibility to go to the 100% virtualized is also to do the same with desktops. Now, with desktop it is not as a straightforward operation as with the servers, where we change not much in a way how system works. So with servers, we had all the services in the data center, and with virtualization it stayed the same, and we used the information and services the same way. When we move the desktops to the data center, then we are introducing more computing power, we are putting again hypervisor on the bare metal installation on the server, and on this hypervisor we are running now not server but desktop virtual machines or server virtual machines that are providing desktop sessions. We need additional capacity on the server for these virtual machines, user data and so on. But before with desktops, we used local operating system, local applications, local data, local peripherals. It means that the local PC was taking care of how to handle peripherals. We had all the drivers, local graphic card was in charge of doing the graphic processing. Now, when we move the virtual machine to the data center, we need to redirect the peripherals, we need to redirect a lot of data. And we are introducing possibly some challenges. If all the peripherals will work, if all the applications will work, if we will have the OpenGL, DirectX, whatever we need in the virtual machine in the data set, the same as we can in the PC. If we compare, what is the difference between physical PC installation and virtual desktop or cloud client computer? Why would we consider doing it? Because there are advantages and disadvantages of each situation. Now, when we talk about physical PC, we can easily predict cost, we can easily predict how implementation will work. So, if we have 50 users using PC, we need exactly the same number of the PC, we know the price per unit, we can calculate the capital expense. We can even calculate how much maintenance will cost pretty much easily. When it comes to the implementation, it includes a lot of manual labor, not only to implement, but also later to maintain. But we can also predict how things will work and how it will work. When it comes to maintenance, it needs significant effort. So when we have general purpose operating system at the endpoint, it requires patching, we need to take care about patching, we need to take care about the hardware that is not as reliable as when we talk about the thin clients. The users do different things on the general purpose system that allows a lot of things. They install applications on their own, they corrupt something, they lose something, they delete something. Then, if we have data on the endpoint, there is also a challenge how to secure this data, backup this data, how not to lose this data, how to share this data, and so on. So we have also security challenges. So these are pros and cons to the PCs. When it comes to the virtual infrastructure, we would consider moving to the virtual structure because we want to simplify, automate, centralize, increase security, and have system more flexible. Now this is the benefit of virtualization. But when we start to think how to implement, there are some challenges. It can be complex. It is hard to say what is the perfect server configuration, storage configuration. Should we use this storage or that storage? Do we need how much speed we need? How much RAM? How much CPU? Can we put 100 users on the server, or can we put 500 users on the server? This is all something that we cannot say so clearly. So what hardware do I need? What software do I need? What about licensing? Are we going to use pay Microsoft for remote desktop services, or we need maybe some functionality that will bring Citrix or VMware? How much does it cost? Which license type I need? With the desktop we can say, okay, I need Windows 7 or 8, enterprise, professional, few choices. And if you look at the table, you can say, okay, this is right for me. With the virtual infrastructure, it can be more difficult to choose. And on the end, will it work? So if we invest $150,000 in the data center, implement the desktop infrastructure for 200 users, and we run that, and users start to complain, performance is not good, I cannot work, and so on. Yeah? So will it work? So these are the issues why desktop virtualization is not widely accepted as server virtualization today, and I will try to clarify on that in the next slides. So when we talk about how much PC infrastructure costs, so there are different reasons also why would you move to virtual. Usually the main driver is to save on cost. So I will be comparing cost as a primary influencer. Yeah? So I have came up with some numbers for the PC that we use in the office today. I have heard from one customer today that he was paying like 100 euro for a PC. Maybe it is possible, I don't know. Tell me if I'm wrong, but I was considering some kind of brand name type of PC, like coming from Dell. at one of the slides, I have seen that the number for OptiFlex 710 that was used in calculation was $1,100. So based on that, I have selected some prices. For capital expense, it means the price of the PC, including Windows license, but not including monitor. When I compared with the cost of the virtual infrastructure, I was also not adding the monitor price because it is the same in both cases. Yeah? So I compared only what is different. So with the standard Office PC, I thought this is something that somebody would use in standard Office use case using standard Office applications, emailing, internet browsing. And I figured out it could be like $500 range with the Windows license. For operating expenses, I used 3 year expense of $300. I'm not sure if I'm correct that in Romania, kilowatt hour price is like 10 cents, something in that. It depends, okay. Maybe it is depends if it's for home or industry. I used some time ago some web portal I searched and I find out it is like 10 cents or 9 and 12 or something like that. So I used 10 cents. I calculated that PC is using 100 watts power when working. Even if we have PCs with 300, 400, 500 watts power supplies, they are not using really the full capacity. This is the maximum they can produce. And I use this average 100 watts for a normal use case. And I came up with 10 cents per kilowatt hour. I came up that for 1 year, PC will use 20 euro of power only. So with the thin client, it is like 10 times less, like 2 euro. So this is a. In this 300 euro, I used dollars, I used like $100 per year. I also calculated on 3 years because I thought this could be some kind of life cycle of a PC. Normally, when you buy PC, standard warranty, I think is 3 years. There is also option for 4 or 5. I'm not sure what is standard. Some customers are changing PCs every 3 years. Some customers are using them for 6, 10. Yeah. So, but I figured out after 3 years, there could be significant improvement in hardware. There will be new operating systems. I'll calculate it with 3 years, and especially because the warranty I thought it would be normal is 3 years. So I use OPEX for 3 years. One customer in Romania told me that they came up with their own calculation and they calculated they are using $700 for maintenance of every PC per 3 year period. So I'm not sure if this is realistic. I use like $300 as more conservative figure. The other $80 per year would go to regular visit to the PC to clean up the dust from the power supply, and something needs to be fixed, something needs to be changed. So I figured out that the transport of the device, going on site, all kind of management time we use should be in that range. So total cost of ownership, I came up with $800 for standard PC. For more advanced PC, I use $700 as capital expense and the same operating expenses. And high-end PC, I use this OptiFlex 710. With Windows license, it's $100. So TCO would be 1,500 per 3 years. So I'm not sure if you think this is realistic or I should decrease that. Or could work. Depends on exact situation. Now you will see, I have provided also some examples. There are so many variations, what you have, what you do, and what you need, and everybody will come up with different calculations. So I try to cover some most common scenarios, but I really only touched the top of the iceberg. Yeah? So also when it comes to the PC, you need to really consider what is the real cost in your company, how much you pay for PC and how much really you spend to run it. Then you will have a number on the left side. And on the right side, to come up with a number is a little bit more difficult than one slide. So, I just wanted to illustrate how typical desktop virtualization project infrastructure needs to look like. So, this is all in the data center except the client. So, the client could be access device, thin client, or PC, mobile device, whatever. But this is all in the data center. I took this picture from a Microsoft website from this address. If you Google for Microsoft Remote Desktop Services, this is probably one of the first links that will come out. There is also a lot of text explaining what every component is doing. So, to make the infrastructure that you need in the data center to be able to connect remotely, you need the following components. Remote desktop connection broker. Connection broker is your door where you authenticate with your client. So for example, you have a PC, you run remote desktop connection. In the address where you are connecting, you need to put the address of the remote desktop connection broker. Remote desktop connection broker will then, after it authenticates you, it will check your credentials in Active Directory. It can be more complex than only username and password. You can use also smart cards, fingerprint readers, whatever you implement. But normally you can use only username and password. You are checked in Active Directory and you are connected to your resource that is published. Depending on your implementation type, you might have published application only for the users or more applications. You can publish desktop session from the server where multiple users are accessing the same server, having the whole desktop with the start menu, desktop and anything. Not application only, but the whole session. Or you can have connection to the full virtual machine that can be desktop virtual machine for every user, one virtual machine. This could be Windows 7 or Windows 8 in this machine. Or even it can be a Windows server acting as a standalone system that sometimes is the choice because of some licensing reasons. So in case you are using a published application or desktop session from a server, you will be using remote desktop shared host. This is type of computing server. When I say computing server, I mean the server which is working the user workload. So connection broker is management type of virtual machine, only directing things, and this one is doing the job. It is called the remote desktop shared host per Microsoft terminology. This is the new server, new name for the former terminal server role on Windows 2003 and 2008. 2008 is also the remote desktop shared host. So in case you are accessing the full virtual machines, you have a remote desktop virtualization host. It would be a server with a hypervisor, for example, in Microsoft case, Hyper-V, with many, many virtual machines with Windows 7, for example. You can have, let's say, 150 virtual machines with Windows 7 on top. In this case, you have, for 100 users, only two virtual machines, 50 sessions per machine, two server machines publishing the application. So this is two types of servers doing the workload. A remote desktop connection broker, I already mentioned, is using some of the services as Active Directory from the infrastructure, but other components needed are licensing server that needs to, where connection broker is checking if you have enough licenses for your users that are connecting to the system. Then you have remote desktop web access. So one way of connecting is using remote desktop client. And the other way of connecting is using web portal to have a login page on the web, in a browser, and authenticate over the web portal. So in this case, you would be installing remote desktop web access role on the management machine. And RDG means Remote Desktop Gateway, that in case you are connecting from from Open Internet, then normally because of security reasons, you are putting a modesto gateway to secure the entrance to your connection broker and not connection broker to be published on the internet. So these are workers and these are all management services. Some of these normally you would already have in your infrastructure, like Active Directory. Some of them you can put on the same virtual machine or server, like connection broker and web access you can put on the same place. Gateway should be the separate, and licensing server you can also put on some existing machine. You don't have really to follow the procedure to have one service. So this is what you need in the data center from a logical layout, or logical point of view. How it will look in hardware? Yeah, well, this is what I was explaining on the previous slide. So, what can be published resources? Session-based desktop, this is a session from the remote desktop shared host. Usually you use 50 users per system, that is normally virtual machine. So, on a physical box, you can have, for example, 300 users. It means you will have 6 server machines servicing up to 50 users each. Yeah? So that will be the physical world. Then, to license this, you will need Windows Server 2012 R2 license for each 100 users. Why? Because Windows Server standard license is allowing you to run 2 server systems in 2 virtual machines on the same physical box. So if you use 50 users per virtual machine, you can have 100 users on 2 virtual machines and you need one license for that. So you should calculate with the license cost for the server. This I found on the internet, also on the Microsoft site, $882 per standard license. Yeah? So it would be $8.82 per user. And you need also remote desktop services client access licenses. That is normally around $100 per user. That is the license paying once as a license for a physical PC that you pay once. Yeah? So this is what you pay once and need to have for every user. This is the cost for this kind of implementation. Similar is remote app. This is also the same layout, but you're not publishing the desktop session, but only applications. So also the sizing is same, the pricing is same, the licensing is the same. When we talk about remote desktop virtualization cost, we will be running Windows desktop, Windows 7, 8 virtual machine per each user. So the server will have to be more powerful for the same number of users because now we have, for example, for 100 users we have 2 Windows kernels running on the box, and here for 100 users we have 100 kernels running on the box. More RAM for 100 instances of Windows desktop and so on. So hardware, server hardware needs to be bigger. What we need is virtual desktop access subscription. Because to be legal to run Windows 7 in a virtual machine, you need this. You cannot buy OEM licenses for PC. Yeah? So this is subscription. So you pay $100 per user per year for this. So this is more expensive, and it is recommended to avoid this expense if you are able to implement this or that scenario to avoid the full virtual desktop scenario because of the cost. Sometimes, because of technology differences, you will need to use virtual desktops. Personal virtual desktops are similar as pooled. Also, you have full virtual machines. But in this case, it is more standardized. So, you are when connecting, you are grabbing first available image. It is joined with your user profile and your published applications. And you, when you work, when you disconnect, the image is put back to the pool and reset it to the default state. So it is more standardized environment and not so many differences between many virtual machines. So when we talk about personal virtual desktop, it allows more freedom to the user to customize the environment. And in this case, when you are connected to one image, the changes are preserved, and next time when you connect, you will be connected to the same image with the same state as you have left it last time. So for this you need probably more storage space, and it will be some constraints when it comes where you can store this. Because when it comes to high availability, normally you would use, if you need one server for the workload, you need another server for high availability. So if one fails, the other will take over the job. If you put the personalize in with preserved changes on the first server and this server fails, you can never connect the same user to the second server because he has no personal spine. So in this case, you are limited to use shared storage. That could be expensive. In this case, you can use both shared storage or local storage in the server systems. So these are most common scenarios. Okay, there are some other, but also I'm talking about Microsoft because there are too many options. No? When we talk about Citrix or VMware, this is variation, but the layout is similar. With the VMware, you will also have connection broker. With the Citrix, you will have connection broker. What is with Microsoft web interface? This is with Citrix storefront. No? So what is the gateway with Microsoft? With Citrix, it is Netscaler. Also, there is a connection server, I think with VMware, that is gateway. There is a connection broker. The similar components are in all the infrastructure. So I will be talking today about Microsoft, but you can apply the same principle to other technologies. So when it comes to licensing, if you use the application virtualization or desktop sessions from a server, you need user device or device RDS card license. In case of desktop virtualization for VDI, you need VDA subscription. So when you add, for example, another functionality, another broker, for example, VWorkspace coming from Dell, you need, you cannot replace these licenses with VWorkspace licenses. So it is not really a decision, should I pay for Microsoft or I will not pay for Microsoft, I will pay for VMware. No, you are paying because you are, if you are using VMware or Microsoft or Citrix, you are still using Microsoft operating system in the background and you need to license Microsoft per the same principle. So you are paying additional for VWorkspace, Premiere for this scenario or therefore for this scenario, or you are paying for Microsoft and additionally for Citrix, Zera for Zen Desktop, for different scenarios, or you are paying for Microsoft and additionally for VMware, for Horizon View Advanced, now having in version 6 application virtualization, or standard doing VDI scenario. Now, why would you pay additional if this infrastructure can supply what you want? Well, all this price is not by accident. All these solutions can bring value to your system. So depending on your use case, maybe your challenges will be answered only by ZenApp capabilities because there is more advanced management interface, there is different protocol implemented, there is more efficient in LAN or WAN, there is different multimedia mechanism. For example, if you have call center, you will have advantages of using one protocol over the another when it comes to voice, real-time voice redirection or something like that. So you should also consider different technologies if Microsoft is not fulfilling your needs. So this is what you need on the infrastructure side when it comes to licensing and components. This is what you need on the endpoint. Normally, the best practice would be to use the thin client. I have put here a few characteristic models. We have a much broader portfolio than that. But I wanted to show you what is the price range of these models. This one, I have in the ground floor on the desk. I can show you, T10. It is Ansible Core for standard office use case. You can purchase it for around $300. Now, again, when I talk about prices, you are not buying one thin client. You're buying 100 or 1,000 or 150 or 50. So you will always have project pricing. This is not consumer product. So this price will vary. For example, when I say $800 here, if you are buying 1,000 pieces, it will be much less. So use it as orientation. So this is for standard use case, for task and standard office workers can be quite sufficient. This is based on TinOS. Very simple system to use and very, very low maintenance cost. 3290 is looking like that. This is the latest model, very efficient with the price, very good characteristic, dual core, Intel based 1.6 GHz, running on Windows MIDI 7 standard. Let's say the cost is around $450. This one is running on Windows 8 MIDI standard, EMD dual core 165 GHz, let's say $700. And this one has quad core CPU, 2 GHz quad display capable out of the box. You will need it for advanced multimedia graphic requirements. Let's say it is around $800. So, I explained in the data center how is logical layout, and I want to show you how physical layout looks like, what hardware you really need to purchase. So, I have talked yesterday, we have reference architecture where we have described building blocks that you need in the data center and how to set them up, how to size them. So normally, we use following building blocks. Networking switch, top of the rack, we use 410 ES55. In my calculations later, I was using approximately price of $7,000 per switch. I found this on the internet. Then, management server. It is not very powerful server comparing to the computing servers. So currently in our reference architectures it is still stated R420, but we are moving this to R430 latest generation. I was using something, I think $3,000 or $4,000 for this server. It has dual CPU, it is configured with 64 gigabytes of RAM and two hard drives for running the local system. Two drives, because of high availability, they are configured in RAID 10, so this is only to boot the local hypervisor. On it, you will put your licensing server, connection broker, a gateway, a virtual machine. This can all be virtual machines, and you will normally put it on another server. This says, one time, if you are using high availability scenario, you will need to buy two to have high available infrastructure. Compute server, you will use, there are a few options. You can use smaller server, or you can use more powerful server that will allow you bigger consolidation rate, bigger number of users on the server, depending if you have great number of users or small number of users, one or other scenario could be more efficient for you. We use 730. I used price for that depending on the configuration from $11,000 to $20,000. Then, in some cases, we are using a file server for the duplication. That is used actually in one of the scenarios only. This is F7620. I think it is, I use $5,000 to $10,000 for that, I'm not sure. And for storage also, you have some options, and you can also replace I have used iSCSI storage in my configurations with depending on the parameters I put in, the configurator according to our reference architecture proposed for 4100E, Equilogic or 6100E or hybrid storage array 6100XE that I calculated with $85,000 in price with the configuration that is in the so these are different building blocks depending on your size, on your what type of virtualization you choose. You will need one or the other will be better for you. I have some examples there. So on management server you are putting these services, on computing service you are putting servers for shared host or virtualization host virtual machine installations. In your infrastructure, probably you already have some kind of virtualization. So you can reuse some of the components, like networking switch. Maybe you don't need to buy two management servers because you have place for two simple virtual machines on existing infrastructure. So later I will be also providing numbers that are for cases when you are partially or more or less utilizing your existing infrastructure and not buying the whole VDI from scratch. The project will probably not work if you are buying everything. Think like all this stuff, storage servers, switches, it will be maybe a very big capital expense, not efficient. But if you reuse what you already have, if you use your existing investment to run some of this capacity and maybe buy only computing servers or computing server and some storage, then you will have a better business case and it might work. So this is what I took from another presentation that I did not make this. So I wanted to show you this as a first example. So we are calculating price of the VDI for a hypothetical customer that is having 2,500 users. They are deploying full VDI, including Zen Desktop licenses. So we are paying for Microsoft and Zen Desktop licenses. What we compare with is physical system they are hypothetically normally buying, and it is used Optiplex 7010, okay. They say it is $1,094, and it says it includes 19-inch monitor, okay. And for the thin client, we have used $300 price for the thin client, and in this case, with monitor, they also showed the number with monitor, 418. For the data center infrastructure, I'm not sure which configuration they came up to, but when divided with 2,500 users, they came up that the network is $33 per user, storage $171, and servers $157 per user. This is only hardware. So they came up that the hardware for the VDI will be in range of $700-something. If you buy everything, if you are using mid-DC leverage. Mid-DC leverage means that you are buying only servers and the thin clients. So it is assumed that you already have enough storage capacity in existing old infrastructure and network switching of your own. So you are buying only servers and thin clients. Then they came up with the same number for servers and they removed this price. They came up with a lower number to invest in your project. High DC leverage means you have everything in the data center already and you are buying only thin clients. Now, maybe it is not realistic that you have existing server virtualization infrastructure in the data center with enough capacity to run 2,500 user full VDI machines and that you do not need to buy. So this is not very realistic for me. They calculated the license cost, then calculated what you need to pay for hypervisor, for broker, other voice SQL licenses you get, I'm not sure what is SA, and physical desktop software. So physical desktop software means this was the Windows license for the desktop, and this is all what we need in the data center. It's something similar that I was talking about later. So they came up, this licensing cost is more expensive. And they added these numbers, and they came up. If you buy everything, you are a little bit more expensive than a PC. If you buy part of the equipment for the data center, you are even less expensive than a PC. And if you have everything in the data center and buying only endpoint and paying for licensing, you are less expensive than the PC. So for this customer, it would make sense depending on the existing infrastructure, what they need to do, can they use one of these scenarios, they can make their business case, what is the investment, and they will help transform their infrastructure to more efficient infrastructure, and it will make sense, because running this after capital expense would be much less. Now, I was doing some number crunching on my own. I think I will use too much time. So this is what I used as profiles. It is important to understand, when you size the server, if you have R730 with 256 gigabytes of RAM, with some number of drives, it is not the same if you are playing multimedia or you are using single application, what your user is doing. So we have classified in a reference architecture users in some standard types. Standard means one or few applications, light workload. So not much read CPUs needed, not much RAM, and not much input-output operation in average. So we are talking about IOPS in average because you have, let's say, 200 users on the machine. If somebody is doing something, he will generate maybe 50 IOPS at one moment, but not everybody will do that at the same moment. So in average, this subsystem will be able to supply peaks for separate users. So in average, this is what we came up in reference architectures after testing. So this is what we came up with. So enhanced profile would be somebody using a whole set of Office application, maybe doing some light graphics like preparing the PowerPoint presentation, so on, internet browsing. Professional profile would be more demanding, doing the big working with bigger files than enhanced profile. And we also have shared graphics that I did not calculate for. This scenario, it means that in the data center we also have GPU cards in the servers that are assisting the servers to do the graphic calculations if you are using graphical demanding applications. So we can virtualize pretty much all standard workloads that are on the market in the field today. So this will illustrate how the users will size. This is copy-paste from the reference architecture document, how the users will size per server. This is on 730 rack mount server. So we can have, for example, shared session scenario. It means we will have biggest density with this scenario. We can have around even 500. These numbers are for standard users. 500 users. But if our users are more like enhanced profile, then not 500 but 300 users on the same card. And professional users even less, 280. When we talk about full VDI, then this number decreases on the same server card. So we have full VDI for standard users, 345, and 205 for enhanced, and professional 145. These numbers are used in the following slides when I have shown you, will show you four different examples for four different virtualization scenarios for the four different user sizes, numbers, number of users. So this, I show you how the sizing works. It is explained in much more details in our reference architecture. This is the next one, interesting. So this is scenario, remote desktop shared host, local tier one means that we also define the storage in the reference architecture as tier one storage and tier two storage. Tier one is the one that needs to be fast, that is running our workload. So it is servicing VDI machines, it is servicing remote desktop shared hosts, running the files of the computing server virtual machines. Tier two storage. Tier two storage is used to save user data, to save files of the management virtual machines, so second priority data. It can be on slower and cheaper storage. Right? So tier one should be on performant storage. Now, in our reference architecture, we also have two scenarios. Tier one storage can be local or shared. If it is local, it means it is part of the server itself. For example, if we have four computing hosts, every of them will have, let's say, 6, 8, 16 local disks. And this local disk will run the workload. We can use it for every scenario except for this personalized scenario that I before explained. So in this scenario, I choose local tier one storage. It should be more efficient in some scenarios than buying expensive shared storage. And if we can use it, we can utilize it. So the configurator gave me the. I also used high available checkmark. So everything like top of the rack switch, you see. Number of switches is two. We could normally use one, but because of high availability, we need two. Also, management server, we have two. On all the examples, you will see that these kind of components are doubled because of the high availability. For 50 users, we normally need one computing server, cheaper one, 420, is capable of running 50 users. We have two because of high availability. Now, the number I came up with, I added all the prices and divided by number of users. I came up, it is $980 to buy all the redundant infrastructure new for 50 users, so it could be not make sense to virtualize with all these components. But if you are using mid DC11, it means you are buying only computing costs, these two costs, then it is going down to only 200. You can easily, for these two costs, use existing switch, you can use existing tier 2 storage, and you can use existing hypervisor platform to run these few management machines you need. So I use the same example for 100 users, this time utilizing this small the server with smaller density, then I needed 2 plus 1. So I needed 3 servers. When I run the 100 users with the more powerful density server, I came up with only 2. So in this case, per user, it came up less expensive to have 3 small than 2 big. But if I use 70 users, maybe I will need, it will came up differently. So it is very hard to illustrate. Yeah? So in some other examples, it will be the other way. So for 200 users and 500 users, I got the same size, the different sizing from the configurator, and I got these prices for the hardware when I calculate. Yeah, so I use all my time. So I will just a few more minutes. So I put this number in red because I used it later as an example calculation for a total cost of ownership. Okay? So 200 users need this leverage, quite possible scenario to have for the infrastructure part only $120 per user. So the other is also Rigaud desktop share cost, but this time it's share storage. It means we will have no local distance servers, but we are buying Equilogic for tier 1 and tier 2 storage. This time we are using 6100 XS. This is the one hybrid with SSDs and SAS. So this stuff is $85,000. So this is why for 50 users I came up with $2,000 per user of hardware cost. But you see, when you go to 500 users, it is 272. So it is coming down really quickly. If you use mid DC leverage, only 66. So this example I did not calculate with on the end. This is pooled VDI. I used local storage. This is possible with pooled VDI because virtual machines are in templates, cloned and returned to default state. So you can use local storage in the computing servers. I came up with numbers from $1,000 for 50 users on biggest cost down to 152 with mid DC leverage for 500 users. I was using 190 example for the total calculation on the end. So these are the configuration. You see, when we use local disks, we need 16 disks in the server. This is a persistent VDI with the shared tier 1 storage. You see, the computing server disk is going down because we are moving the virtual machines to the shared storage. Again, we are using expensive storage, but even with this storage for 500 users, we are going down to some small numbers. So I used 366. When you are buying storage and adding all the components for 500 users as a calculation. So I have 2 more slides, very simple. So I use this, 120, 190, 366. This is mid DC leverage, this is buying all the equipment. I use the Microsoft licensing needed. I calculated with some number of server licenses, I presume should be sufficient. So here I use three standard licenses, right? One for 2 management servers, and 2 licenses to run virtual machines. Here I use also 3, and here I use 4 or 5 licenses. I divided the price of the license with the number of users. So here I came up with $13, here with $8. I used RDS CALS as one-time expense, and here I use VDA license that you pay every year, so I use 3 times $100 because I also calculated. Thin client, I used Office $300 model. Here I used also TinOS model that I did not show on that slide, but I presume $400 would be normal price. And here I used this Windows 8 that I said it is around $700. When I added these numbers, data center infrastructure, Microsoft licensing, thin client, I came up with these numbers, and every time I came up with the less expense than a PC that I'm comparing with from the slide before. Now, real calculation for your scenario could be different. It is on this slide previously. If I use 200 users, I come up with one number. If I use 250, maybe it will be much better consolidation date, and I will come up with a different number. So we need to do calculation for your scenario and see what licenses really you need and what is your scenario. So what I wanted to recommend for you, if you want to have a feeling, to have a conclusion what you need, you need to consider what you are doing, what are your user types, what are your applications, can they be virtualized on the remote desktop shared host, or you need full VDI. If you need full VDI because of one business application that is legacy application, not running on terminal server, you can consider to postpone the virtualization project. If you are planning to modernize the application, if you want to change to maybe web application or even to modernize it to be able to work on the terminal server, then not to invest in VDI, not to make this, just perform the VDI until you are capable of doing RDSA. Do you need other vendors because of the functionality? About the endpoint, you need Windows if you need flexible endpoint, but maybe you can change something, the how you scan, how you print, maybe you can use simply an endpoint, therefore you will save on cost for every desk, and you will save on maintenance. The simpler, the better, this is what I have concluded. And consider usage of your existing data center infrastructure, so you are not buying everything new. Leverage the existing investment in the existing hardware you have. So after you consider all that, you can come up with something that is ideal scenario for you, and you will know. So please address me or our colleagues from Meta to you. We can make some qualification of your scenario, and we can talk in more details about this stuff.
So what's new in this presentation? What did Dell do to attract us? This was only for some campus. We could have calculated it ourselves, please.
About the presentation,
yeah.
I wanted to show you how possible infrastructure can look like and what could be the cost. If you are saying I need 50 PCs, I will multiply 300 times 50, this is the cost. But do you know how much VDI infrastructure will cost? You cannot know. Maybe it is 50,000, maybe it's 150,000. Now I wanted to explain what you need to consider and how can calculate to come up with a number so you will know what is the virtualization scenario for you, and you can compare. This one.